AutoGPT is an open source application that takes the power of GPT models to a whole new level. Chatbots like ChatGPT are impressive in their own right, but they are limited to a basic back and forth conversation between a user and the bot. AutoGPTs are applications that use the underlying GPT models like GPT 3.5 and GPT 4 to automate AI-driven tasks. The user simply provides an end goal and the application will figure out the steps to get there. Back in April 2023, I released a video covering AutoGPT, and a whole lot has changed since then. This video is an update to that video, but I'm also going to include the lessons that I've learned since then to improve the final results produced by AutoGPT. We will also have a look at some of the additional functionality that was introduced since then, and as an added bonus, we will also have a look at some web-based alternatives to running AutoGPT locally. This is my ultimate guide to using AutoGPT. So, what do you need to follow along with this video? This video is beginner-friendly, and you do not need any coding experience to follow along. We will have a look at how you can set up AutoGPT locally on your machine, but we will also have a look at some web-based alternatives later on in this course. So, if your machine is not powerful enough to run a local install of AutoGPT, you will still benefit from this video. Because AutoGPT is rapidly evolving and videos on the topic become outdated very quickly, I recommend that you keep an eye on the official AutoGPT documentation for any changes or updates. So what is an AutoGPT? Autonomous GPTs are applications that use GPT models under the hood for executing a set of goals until the desired results are met. You can basically see AutoGPT as an intern that can assist you or your business with simple tasks. For instance, you can ask AutoGPT to perform some research for you on a specific topic and then write an article based on the results. It can then write the results to a file and save it on your local machine. With plugins, you can also ask AutoGPT to email you the results. Basically, all you have to do is provide AutoGPT with the final goal or a list of goals, and the application will do the rest. There is a very big and important caveat to this. These AutoGPT applications are still under active development, and you will run into issues from time to time, like error messages and infinite loops. And the final outcome might also not be what you wanted. However, this cutting-edge technology is rapidly improving, and now is a great time to familiarize yourself with these applications and their uses. Before we start with the AutoGPT installation, we first need to install Python. AutoGPT was written with a Python programming language, so it requires Python to be set up on your PC in order to work. In the description of this video, you'll find a link to this page, and all you have to do is scroll down to the files section and then download the file that corresponds to your operating system. Because I'm using Windows, I'll download the Windows 64-bit installer. After running this file, you should see a window like this. Before clicking on Install Now, ensure that you check this box for Add Python to Path. After checking this, you can go ahead and click on Install Now. I've already installed Python, so I'm not going to do it again. We can then move on to installing AutoGPT. Let's talk about how you can access the AutoGPT documentation, and let's continue to set up AutoGPT on our PC. You can access the official AutoGPT website by going to agpt.co, and you should see a page like this. And this really is the best place to go to stay up to date with everything AutoGPT. Another useful resource is to visit the documentation section of this website by clicking on Docs. Within documentation, you can learn everything there is to know about AutoGPT. As an example, we can go to the setup page to see the setup instructions for running AutoGPT on our own machine. If you get stuck at any point during this video, I highly recommend going back to this documentation to ensure that nothing has changed in terms of the setup instructions. Let's go ahead and set up AutoGPT on our own machine. The first thing we need to do is to create a new folder on our machine. I just called it AutoGPT. We then need to download AutoGPT to our machine. The first thing we need to do is to download AutoGPT to our PC. And there are a few ways we can do this, but I found that the easiest way to get started is to simply download the latest stable release. So within the documentation, scroll down to this section for setting up without Git or Docker. You can then find the download link over here. After clicking that link, you should be redirected to GitHub. And by the time you watch this video, this version might be slightly different, but nonetheless, you are on the correct page. All you have to do then is scroll down to the bottom and under assets, go ahead and download any of these two files. I'll download the zip file. After downloading this file, I will move it to the folder that we created earlier and simply extract the contents. After extracting the contents, we can actually remove the zip file as it's no longer required. And we can then drill into the folder that was created. Within this folder, look for the file called .env.template and rename this file. And we simply need to rename it to .env. So we need to remove the .template part of this. We then need to open this file in a text editor like Notepad. Alternatively, you can open this file in a code editor. And just to make things a bit more readable for this tutorial, I'll be using VS Code. After opening this file in your text editor, you should see something like this. Note that this file is also changing all the time as new features are added to AutoGPT. But one thing that should stay the same is this variable over here. In order to use AutoGPT, we need to give it access to the OpenAI APIs by providing this API key. So what we need to do next is create an API key and then add it to this file. In order to create an API key, a new API key, you need to go to the following URL. Go to platform.openai.com. Go ahead and create a new account. And after your account was created, you should see a page like this. Please note that this is a paid service and there is a small cost associated with each API call. However, after creating your account, you should receive some free credits. We can now go ahead and create our API key by clicking on Personal, then click on View API Keys, then click on Create New Secret Key, give your key a name like AutoGPT, and copy this key. Please note that I'll delete this key after this recording, so please use your own key. Then go back to the .env file and replace this text with your key so it looks like this. We can now save our .env file and close it. We can now go ahead and install all the dependencies for AutoGPT and then run AutoGPT. In this folder, scroll down and then double click on the run.bat file. When running the file, you might get a pop-up like this. You can just go ahead and click on run anyway. This will open a command prompt and it will start installing the Python dependencies for AutoGPT. And after the dependencies have been installed, AutoGPT will start up instantly. Let's quickly talk about the two different ways that you can provide a goal to AutoGPT. The default behavior is for AutoGPT to give you this prompt saying, I want AutoGPT to, and now you can provide the goal for AutoGPT. So let's give it a basic instruction for this demo. Create 10 unique and family-friendly jokes and write the results to a text file. Let's press enter. So the first thing you'll see is that AutoGPT created the following. It assigned a name to the AI. It also assigned a role as well as a list of goals that it needs to execute to get to the result. The role provides some very important context to the AI and the goals is like a to-do list of steps that it needs to execute to achieve the final goal. And how this works is behind the scenes, AutoGPT is calling one of the GPT models to generate the name, the role, as well as the list of goals. AutoGPT will now try to execute the first step in the goal list. For each step that it executes, it will always give you the thoughts, the reasoning, a plan, as well as a criticism. And let's quickly discuss each of these. The thoughts will tell us what AutoGPT is planning to do next. For instance, I think it would be fun to generate some jokes. For the reasoning, it will tell us why it came up with this step. As a jokester AI, generating jokes is one of my core competencies. It's a great way to entertain and delight people of all ages. It will also give a plan for the specific set. This plan is different to the overall goals for this prompt. But instead, the plan is like a list of tasks that it needs to execute, but this list is specific to this step only. Then it also provides a criticism, which is basically a way for the model to verify that the end result matches what it intended to do in this step. We also get this very important section called next action. Next action gives us a command as well as the arguments for the command. And this command is sort of the technical step that it plans to execute next. Because we asked AutoGPT to write jokes to a file, it says that it's going to call the command write to file with some arguments. The arguments will depend on the command that is being executed. And for the write to file command, AutoGPT typically needs to specify the file name. And in this case, it's going to write the file to this location called jokes.txt, and it also provides a text argument, which is the content of the file being written. So this next action step is a very good way of verifying that AutoGPT is doing the right thing. We are expected to provide additional input. Our options are the following. If we type no, it means that we are disapproving of this command and processing will terminate immediately. We can approve this command by pressing Y and enter, and AutoGPT will then execute this command and then move on to the next goal. AutoGPT will ask us to provide input for each and every step. If we wanted AutoGPT to automatically continue with the next few steps without us having to approve it, we can type Y followed by dash and the number of steps that we want to approve in advance. For instance, if I typed dash 5, AutoGPT will automatically run the next 5 steps without asking for our approval. Then lastly, AutoGPT might ask the user for additional input, which we can type in this field. We can also use the input field to guide AutoGPT in a different direction in the event that any of these steps are not correct. In this case, everything seems fine, so I'll just press Y and enter. For the next step, we will now receive a system message. System message is basically giving us feedback from the previous command. And in this case, it's saying that the command write to file was successful. So now the new thoughts are, I want to make sure that the jokes I generated are truly original and have not been previously published or widely circulated. I will use a search engine to check for similar jokes. For the reasoning, it's saying it's important to ensure that each joke is truly original and not just a variation of an existing joke. For the plan, it's saying that it will use a search engine to check for similar jokes, etc. And for the next action, it wants to use Google to get a list of 10 unique and family-friendly jokes. So if we wanted to, we could press Y to continue with this process. But I feel that AutoGPT has already achieved its purpose, so I'm just going to say no and press enter. After pressing N and enter, the command prompt closed automatically. We can see the result by going to the AutoGPT folder. Within the AutoGPT folder, we can look for the folder called AutoGPT_workspace, and it is in this folder that AutoGPT will write the results. And we can see a file called jokes.txt. And if we open that file, we can see the list of jokes. And this is exactly what we asked it to do. It generated 10 family-friendly jokes and it's written it to the file. Let's now have a look at the second way of providing goals to AutoGPT. Let's run AutoGPT again by double-clicking on run.bat. In the command prompt, AutoGPT is now asking us if we want to rerun the previous prompt. If we wanted to, we could just press yes, and AutoGPT will generate 10 new jokes and write it to a file. This message will show up each and every time that we run AutoGPT. If you want to clear this history, what you can do is in the main folder of AutoGPT, look for a file called AI_settings and delete this file. We can then go ahead and run AutoGPT again, and this time there's no history. The second way of providing a goal to AutoGPT is to manually enter the goal details. So instead of providing a prompt, we can type dash dash manual and then press enter. This is my preferred way of providing prompts to AutoGPT, and in my experience, this has provided the best results. So in this example, let's ask AutoGPT to create a recipe for us and to save the recipe to a file. So we can give our AI a name like Chef GPT. The name of the AI does not play a very big role in the final result. We now need to provide a description or a role for our AI. And this is important and does affect the final result. AutoGPT will use this role to give context to the GPT model, and this does affect the final result. So we will say that Chef GPT is an experienced AI chef that creates unique recipes, and I'll press enter. Now we can enter up to 5 goals for our AI. So for goal 1, I'll say, use Google to find a recipe for any pasta dish. For the second goal, I'll say, write a recipe to a text file. And for the third goal, I'll just say, shut down once done. This will stop AutoGPT from processing once it's written the recipe to a text file. We do not need a fourth goal, so I'll just leave this blank and press enter. We can now specify a budget. I'll just leave this blank and press enter. So for the thoughts, it's saying, I think I should start by finding a pasta recipe to work with. And it's going to use the Google command to search for a pasta recipe. And for the next actions, we can see that the command is indeed Google with a query of pasta recipe. This example actually demonstrates one awesome ability of AutoGPT. AutoGPT has access to the internet, so it will go and Google a recipe. So for the input, we'll just press Y and enter. So now we can see the system response, and in this response, we can see some result being returned from Google. And this is basically a list of URLs with recipes. For the thoughts, AutoGPT is saying that it found a recipe on the Food Network website that looks promising. So it's going to use the write to file command to now save this recipe to a file on our PC. In the next action, we can see the command write to file, and in the arguments, we can see again the file name that it's being written to, as well as the contents for the file. I'll go ahead and approve this. And we can now see the system message saying that the write to file command was successful. We can also see some additional thoughts, reasoning, and the plan for the next step. But it seems like AutoGPT has decided to come up with its own unique recipe, and it wants to write that recipe to a file. This is not necessary, so I'll just say no, and we'll exit out of this. We can have a look at the file that was written by going to the AutoGPT folder. Then we can go to the AutoGPT workspace folder. And within this folder, we can see this file called pasta_recipe. And in this file, we can see the ingredients as well as the cooking instructions for this pasta dish. Let's now also have a look at how we can change the prompt during execution. I've started up a new instance of AutoGPT. Let's go ahead and manually enter our prompt. I will give my AI a name like Celeb GPT. For the role, I will enter an AI assistant that researches celebrity news. And for the goals, I'll say, find out who Olivia Wilde's boyfriend is. For goal 2, I'll say, find out what her boyfriend's age is. And for goal 3, we'll say, write his name and age to a text file. And for goal 4, I'll say, terminate once done. We can leave goal 5 blank and just press enter. For the budget, I'll just press enter. So for step 1, AutoGPT is giving us the correct thoughts, reasoning, and the plan. And I'm happy with the action to go and Google Olivia Wilde's boyfriend's name. So let's assume we made a mistake. And instead of Olivia Wilde, we actually meant Emma Watson. We can now also use the input prompt to make changes to the prompt. So let's type the following. I'll say that I made a mistake and I meant Emma Watson and not Olivia Wilde. Let's press enter and see what happens. We can now see that AutoGPT adjusted the prompt for us. Now in the thoughts, we can see that it's saying, I need to find out who Emma Watson's boyfriend is and his age. And we can also see that adjustment on the next action line. Let's go ahead and approve this by pressing Y and enter. We can see that AutoGPT found some information related to Emma Watson's boyfriend from Google, but it's also found multiple articles related to Emma Watson's boyfriend. So in the reasoning, it's now saying that I need to find the most recent and reliable source to determine who her current boyfriend is. And therefore, AutoGPT is now adjusting the Google query to Emma Watson's current boyfriend. And as we can see, AutoGPT took our input and correctly adjusted the prompts and the goals. And again, I'll approve this command by typing Y and Enter. We can now see that AutoGPT found two articles from two different sources. So now it wants to determine which source is better. And because I'm confident in the direction that this is going, I'll actually automatically approve the next five steps and press Enter. AutoGPT is now saying that it found an article that says that People seems to be the most reliable source of this information. So now it's running a command to Google Emma Watson's boyfriend from the site people.com. What's also worth noting here is this line for authorized commands left. Because I automatically approved the next five steps, it's telling us that there's four steps left that have been pre-approved. If we scroll down to the next step, we can see that AutoGPT found an article on People magazine that says that Leo Robinson is Emma Watson's current boyfriend. But as you might recall, we also asked AutoGPT to give us the age of Emma Watson's boyfriend. AutoGPT is also saying that it couldn't find his age on this specific article. Therefore, it's going to perform a Google search to try and find his age. And in the commands, we can see that AutoGPT wants to use Google to try and find his age. In the following step, we can now see that AutoGPT found several articles that state that Leo Robinson's age is 32 years old. And now that we know who Emma Watson's boyfriend is, as well as his age, AutoGPT will write this information to a text file. And therefore, the next command will be the write-to-file command. And in the arguments, we can see the file name that this information will be written to, as well as the content. And if we scroll down, we can see that AutoGPT has completed its task, and therefore we can press any key to terminate this session. We can now go to the AutoGPT folder and then to the workspace folder. And here we can see that file that was generated. And within this file, we get Emma Watson's boyfriend's name as well as his age. However, we can see that the file name still refers to Olivia, and that is purely based on the original prompt. And now you know how to adjust the prompt in AutoGPT to sort of course correct the prompt when AutoGPT goes down the wrong path. Let's have a look at continuous mode. And for the prompt, I'll just say, write a song about my pet. Let's press enter to continue. And we don't need a second goal, so I'll just press enter again. For the budget, I'll just leave it empty and press enter. In this example, I'm not too worried about the steps that it's planning to execute. It's not really relevant for this demo. But what I do want to show you is if we wanted to continue with this process without having to approve each and every step along the way, we could type something like yes to approve the command, then dash, followed by the amount of steps that we want to approve. But we don't know how many steps are needed in this process. It could be few, like 2 or 5, maybe 10. Or for larger prompts, it could take tens to hundreds of steps. So what if we wanted to run AutoGPT in full autonomous mode without having to approve any of the prompts? I'll close the session, and in this folder, there's a file called run_continuous. Running this file will open AutoGPT just as before, but if we scroll up in this command prompt, we can see this message stating that AutoGPT is now running in continuous mode, and we are getting this warning message saying that running AutoGPT in continuous mode is not recommended. And there are several reasons why running AutoGPT in continuous mode is not recommended. Firstly, there's a cost involved for each and every API call to OpenAI, and it's very possible for AutoGPT to get stuck in an infinite loop, and you could be left with a massive bill by the end of it. Also, AutoGPT is able to change and create files on your system and execute commands, which could potentially cause issues to your file system or your operating system. Thirdly, AutoGPT is able to download files from the internet as well. And there's always the risk that AutoGPT could download a malicious file to your PC. Irrespective, continuous mode is a massive feature in AutoGPT, and we will discuss it. So what I would recommend is if you plan on running AutoGPT in continuous mode, don't just leave AutoGPT running in the background, but instead make sure that you supervise the execution of AutoGPT regularly. So in the prompt, I'll just say yes to re-execute our prompt from earlier, but this time AutoGPT will run through the process without asking us for input at any stage. But what we can see here is after the first step, AutoGPT did not ask us to approve the command, but instead automatically went on to the next step. And after about two or three steps, we can see that AutoGPT wrote a file to the workspace called song.txt with some content. And it also seems that with each and every step, AutoGPT is appending additional verses to the file. Let's go ahead and have a look at that file. We'll go to AutoGPT, we'll go to the workspace folder, and let's have a look at this file called song.txt. And within this file, we can indeed see a song being generated. And let's actually put our command prompt and the file side by side to see the file changing as AutoGPT is running through each of these steps. If you wanted to stop AutoGPT's execution, there's basically two ways to do that. On the one hand, you can just close the command prompt. Alternatively, you can just press Ctrl and C, and that will abort the execution as well. I would suggest using continuous mode only if you have a very high confidence level that AutoGPT will not get stuck in an infinite loop. So I've personally found it very useful for executing extremely simplistic tasks, like the examples that we've covered up until now. But for more complex tasks, I highly recommend using the manual mode. Next, I also want to show you how to execute AutoGPT in the console or the command prompt and what the benefits are of doing so. Back in our AutoGPT folder, in the address bar, enter CMD, and this will open up the command prompt window. In the command prompt, we can now execute AutoGPT by typing Python-M and AutoGPT. This will run AutoGPT just as you've seen it up until now. However, I do want to show you a few benefits of using the command prompt. So what we can do using the command prompt is pass in command line arguments. And let me show you a few of these arguments. Firstly, we can type in Python-M AutoGPT, but before we press enter, we can add these arguments by typing double dash followed by the argument name. AutoGPT offers a couple of arguments, and you can find a list of all of these arguments in the usage page in the AutoGPT docs. The first, and probably the most helpful, is dash dash help. The help argument will list all the possible arguments that you can pass into AutoGPT. So let's look at a few of these arguments. The first one is dash dash continuous, and this will run AutoGPT in continuous mode, and this is the exact same behavior that we get from running run underscore continuous dot bat. Another useful argument is speak.
Welcome back. Dot. Would you like me to return to being song GPT?
What the speak argument would do, and hopefully you just heard it, is the speak command will use text-to-speech to make AutoGPT speak. To demonstrate this, I'll just press yes, and let's keep going. And hopefully you'll hear AutoGPT speak.
Song GPT has been created with the following details. I think I should start by brainstorming some ideas for the song about the pet. I can then use those ideas to write the lyrics and come up with a melody. I should also consider the genre of music that would best fit the pet's personality and characteristics. I want to execute write underscore to underscore file.
This is a very cool feature, but the current voice that's used sounds very robotic. But we will have a look at using the 11labs API to create a much more natural sounding human voice later on in this course. We can also change the model that is used by typing GPT-3 only, and this will force AutoGPT to use GPT 3.5 Turbo as the underlying model. GPT-4 is more expensive than GPT-3, but it is way more efficient and accurate in its results. Either way, let's press enter to continue. And now we can see that GPT 3.5 has been enabled, and you can now continue using AutoGPT. Another useful argument, which might be slightly more technical, is the debug argument. With debug, we can see a lot more details on what is happening behind the scenes. For instance, we can see the amount of tokens that are being used as part of the step, as well as the system and user messages generated by AutoGPT. And please note that this user message is not input that we provided, but instead, AutoGPT is acting as a user when interfacing with the GPT models. We can also see which GPT model was used in the step, as well as the temperature and attributes like the max token size. Then we can also see the response returned by the GPT model for this prompt. Debugging can be useful to determine what went wrong with your prompt or a specific step. AutoGPT allows us to configure the project in many different ways. We can view a list of all the available configuration options by going to the documentation. And at the time of recording, we are able to configure the following aspects of AutoGPT. First is the search functionality. Personally, I haven't had any issues with the default search functionality of AutoGPT. But according to the documentation, AutoGPT might be unable to perform web searches, and you might receive an error message like this, where the Google API might return an error message 429. If you get this message, you can have a look at this page in the documentation to see how you can create your own Google Search API and then add it to the documentation. And for this demo, I'm not going to spend too much time working on this step, but what I would like to focus on instead is how we can set up a different memory backend, which is definitely required if you are planning to use AutoGPT in a production environment. I also want to have a look at how we can change that voice from that robotic default voice to something that sounds a bit more human and natural. And we will also have a look at how we can set up image generation so that we can ask AutoGPT to generate images for us. We can configure our AutoGPT project by going back to our AutoGPT folder and then opening the .env file in a text editor. The .env file contains all sorts of parameters that control the behavior of AutoGPT. At the start of this tutorial, we made a change to this file to provide the OpenAI API key, but we will now use this file to enable other features of AutoGPT. So let's have a look at how we can set up a different memory backend, and we will then have a look at how we can set up a different voice using 11 Labs, and we will then have a look at how we can enable image generation using DALL-E. So in order to change our memory backend, we need to scroll down to a section called memory. Basically, how this works is AutoGPT needs some mechanism for storing all the information that it generates. So this information would be the initial prompt that we provided, as well as all the goals that we specified. The memory will also be used to store all the steps that were generated by AutoGPT, as well as the responses generated by each of these steps. By default, AutoGPT uses local memory, and we can see that in the comments over here. Local memory basically means that AutoGPT will store all of that data in a JSON file. And during processing, AutoGPT will look up information from that file. This is fine for a local or development server, but in production, you might need something a bit more robust. AutoGPT offers support for several service providers like Pinecone, Redis, and Milvus. And the AutoGPT team is constantly adding support for additional service providers. For this demo, we'll have a look at how we can set up a Pinecone backend for our project. So the first thing we need to do is go down to this line called memory backend. We need to uncomment this line by removing the hashtag at the start of this line. Also, we need to uncomment the line for memory index, so it looks something like this. Then, since we no longer want to use the local memory, we need to change local to Pinecone. Below this section, we can now see the configuration for each of these backend providers. So for the Pinecone provider, we will uncomment the Pinecone API key, as well as the Pinecone environment variable. We now need to replace these values with the actual Pinecone API key and region. In order to generate the Pinecone API key, you need to go to pinecone.io. You can then go ahead and create your free account, and then after logging in, you should see a screen like this. what we need to do next is go to this project section, and below projects, click on API keys. Then you can copy this environment value and then add that to your environment variable file. We then need to copy the API key, and you can find the value of the key by clicking on this button that says show key value. After copying the key, you can paste that key in the Pinecone API key field and then save the environment variable file. Please note that I will be deleting this key after this recording is done, so please ensure that you use your own key value. After saving the environment variable file, we can go ahead and run AutoGPT. You can now give AutoGPT a prompt. For this demo, I'll just reuse the previous prompt. You will then see a message that says connecting to Pinecone. The first time you run this, it will take a little bit of time because AutoGPT is creating the index in your Pinecone database. And while this is running, I just want to make a little side note. Pinecone is not fully available to the public quite yet, and you need to be added to a waitlist. So please don't worry if you do not yet have access to Pinecone. We will be using local memory in the remainder of this tutorial, but it is important to understand that AutoGPT can be connected to production-ready databases as well. And after a few minutes, AutoGPT created this index in the Pinecone database, and we can now go ahead and use AutoGPT as per usual. But this time, all the data generated by AutoGPT will be stored in this database. But for the remainder of this tutorial, I will revert back to the local database in order for most people to follow along. So we can revert our changes and comment out these two variables, and we can revert back to the local memory backend, like so. Let's now have a look at changing the voice that AutoGPT uses to something that sounds a bit more natural. And for this, we'll be using a service called 11 Labs. 11 Labs offers an AI model that generates human-sounding voices. Let's play an example. So let's give it some text and let's click play.
I love learning about artificial intelligence.
11 Labs also allows us to change the voice that is used. In this dropdown, we can see different voices. Let's try this one.
I love learning about artificial intelligence.
So let's see how we can hook up 11 Labs to AutoGPT. First off, go and create an account. After logging in, click on your profile, then click on profile, and then copy this API key. Then back in our environment variable file, scroll down to this section for TTS provider or text to speech provider. And then in the 11 Labs section, uncomment the 11 Labs API key variable and then paste in your API key. Please use your own key as I will be deleting this one. Then we need to specify which voice we want to use. So go ahead and uncomment these two variables. We now need to find the voice ID that we'd like to use. And just so that we are clear on what these voice IDs refer to, we need to tell AutoGPT which one of these voices it needs to use. And for each of these voices, there's a unique identifier associated with it. We can find the list of voice IDs by going to the AutoGPT documentation, to the voice section, and then on this page, we can see a list of all the names and their associated voice IDs. And each one of these voices are available on the 11 Labs page as well. And if you want to, you can test out the voices on this page to hear what they sound like. So let's just grab two of these keys and then add them to our environment variable file, like so. We can now save the environment variable file, and then we need to run AutoGPT. But as per the previous section, we need to use the command prompt in order to add the speak argument to AutoGPT. So we'll open the command prompt. Then we will type python-m AutoGPT, then --speak in order to enable voice. Let's press enter and hear how this sounds now.
Welcome back. Would you like me to return to being SongGPT?
And hopefully you can hear that this voice is way more natural than the default system voice.
Welcome to AutoGPT. Run with help for more information. Create an AI assistant, input manual to enter manual mode.
Awesome. Now, let's see how we can get AutoGPT to generate images. Let's first have a look at what AutoGPT does if we ask it to generate an image without changing any of the configuration, I'm going to manually enter our prompt. I'll just call my AI image GPT. For the role, I'll say an AI that generates unique images. Then for the goal, I'll keep it simple and I'll just say generate an image of a dog wearing a hat, and I'll execute this. And you will now see that AutoGPT is not generating an image, but it says that it needs to use a Python library called Pillow. And in the commands, it's saying that it needs to execute a Python file, and it's referencing a file in the workspace directory called generateDogWithHat.py. And if we had to go to the workspace folder, you would notice that this file actually does not exist. Clearly, AutoGPT is having trouble executing this instruction. And that is because we haven't yet told AutoGPT which image provider to use. So let's close this session, and then let's go back to our environment variable file. Look for the section called image generation provider, and then look for the variable called image provider and uncomment that variable. Also, we need to uncomment the variable called image size. AutoGPT has support for several image generation providers, and the default provider is DALL-E. And this makes sense because DALL-E is part of OpenAI, and it will use our OpenAI key to generate images. Also, for the image size, we have an option of 256 by 256 pixels, or 512 by 512, or 1024 by 1024. We can see the list of supported providers by going to the documentation. And at the time of recording, AutoGPT has support for DALL-E, Hugging Face, as well as Stable Diffusion. There is a cost involved for generating images with DALL-E, but it is possible to generate images for free using services like Stable Diffusion. I've already created a video to show how you can set up Stable Diffusion on your PC and then hook it up to AutoGPT in order to generate images for free. So please go and check out that video if this is something that you are interested in. But for this demo, we'll simply have a look at using DALL-E. So after making these changes, we can save the environment variable file. We can re-execute AutoGPT. And this time I'm going to say yes to re-execute this previous prompt. And let's see if AutoGPT is now able to generate this image. We can already see a massive difference. In the thoughts, AutoGPT is now saying that it's going to use the generate image command to generate the image of a dog wearing a hat. And it's determined that the generate image command is the best option for generating an image. And in the next command list, we can see that the command to be executed is generate image with the arguments dog wearing a hat. Let's approve this command and see what we get. We are now getting a system message saying that the generate image command returned this message. And basically it's saying that it's generated this image in our workspace directory. And let's see what we got. Within the AutoGPT folder, let's go to workspace. And in workspace, I can see this JPEG image, and we can see that we got an image of a dog wearing a hat. Hopefully, you now have a better understanding of how to customize your AutoGPT project, and AutoGPT is constantly adding additional features and quality of life improvements. So it's definitely worth keeping an eye on this configuration section in the documentation. Let's have a look at plugins. Plugins can be used to extend the core functionality of AutoGPT. We can get started with plugins by going to the plugins page on the AutoGPT documentation. From here, we can click on this link to take us to the plugins repo page. This page will give us instructions on how to set up AutoGPT plugins, and it also provides a list of all the available plugins for AutoGPT. This plugin functionality is still experimental and actively being developed, so please ensure that you follow the latest installation instructions in order to get the best results. Let's have a look at some of the available plugins. I previously created a video covering the email plugin, and what the email plugin allows AutoGPT to do is to connect to your email address, and AutoGPT can then read your emails, draft responses, and also send emails on your behalf. If you would like to see this in action, then please have a look at my AutoGPT plugin tutorial. So for this video, let's use a different plugin just to keep things interesting. So for this tutorial, let's have a look at the Wikipedia search plugin. We can see additional information on any plugin by clicking on the link associated with the plugin. This will list the key features of the plugin as well as some installation instructions. The first thing we need to do is to download the plugin folder to our AutoGPT folder. So in our AutoGPT folder, you can open PowerShell in Windows by clicking on Start and then searching for PowerShell. You should see a prompt window like this. We then need to CD into our AutoGPT folder. And for me, it looks something like this. Once you've navigated to your AutoGPT folder, you can then copy the command from the documentation and then paste it into PowerShell by right-clicking. And we can then press Enter. And this will download the plugins folder to your AutoGPT directory. We can then run the following command to install the plugin dependencies. So I'll just copy this. Then back in PowerShell, I'll execute this command. You will then be asked if you want to add a plugin to the allow list. I will explain what this is in a second, but basically what is happening here is AutoGPT is starting up and it's realizing that we now have a folder containing plugins, and within the plugin folder, there's a plugin for API tools. And it's now asking us if we want to make use of the API plugin. And we will get this prompt for each and every one of the plugins in the plugin folder. And the plugin that we want to use is the Wiki plugin. So I'm going to say no for the API plugin as well as for the space plugin. And I'll just keep saying no until we get to the Wikipedia search plugin. We do not have to do this each and every time we use plugins. And I will show you how we can use configuration to preset which plugins should be used. But for this demo, I'll just say yes to enable the Wikipedia plugin. We can now see AutoGPT running, but we can also see that AutoGPT's Wikipedia plugin has been loaded. I'm going to say no in order to start with a new prompt, and I'm manually going to enter the details of this prompt. We will call our AI WikiGPT. WikiGPT is an AI assistant that performs research by browsing Wikipedia. And for goal one, we'll ask it, research large language models on Wikipedia. For goal two, write a short article based on this research. For goal three, write the results to a text file and include the Wikipedia link. And for goal four, I'll leave it empty and just press enter to continue. And I'll leave the budget blank and press enter. So AutoGPT should now use the Wikipedia plugin to access data on Wikipedia and then continue with the remainder of the goals. This is different to scraping the web, which is sort of the standard behavior for AutoGPT. And the Wikipedia plugin allows AutoGPT to directly access data on Wikipedia, which is way more efficient and accurate. So because the Wikipedia search plugin was loaded, we can see that AutoGPT wants to use the Wikipedia search command to search for our inquiry, which is correct. And in the action list, we can see the command to be used is Wikipedia search, and this is coming from the plugin, with a query for large language models. Let's go ahead and approve this step. And now we can see that we got a response back from Wikipedia, and I'm going to pre-approve the next few steps to see what happens. So what we can see now is that AutoGPT used the Wikipedia plugin to find an article for large language models. And from that result, it found a link to an article on Wikipedia. It then visited that page and extracted the content from that article. And it's then written the article to a local file. So let's go ahead and see the result. In the AutoGPT folder, let's go to our workspace folder. We can now see this file, and within this file we can see the article that was generated. And because I've pre-approved the next few steps, AutoGPT will just keep running, but I think for the purposes of this demo, it's done what we wanted. So I'm going to press Ctrl C to terminate this session. So what I'm going to do now is actually close this session, and what we'll see is that every time we run AutoGPT, we will be prompted again if we want to load these plugins. We can pre-approve these plugins by opening up our .env file in a text editor. And in this file, we can find the section called Allow Listed Plugins. We can now provide a list to allow plugins and a separate list for denying plugins as well, so that we don't have to manually approve these plugins in the command prompt. So let's say we wanted to add the Wikipedia and email plugins to the environment variable file so that we don't have to manually approve these going forward. So all we have to do is copy the name of the plugin like so. Then in the environment variable file, we could just paste the name of the plugin here. And let's also add the Wikipedia plugin. So for now, I'll just say no to these. And I can copy the name of the Wikipedia plugin and then add it to this list as well, separated by a comma. Let's save this file and then let's re-execute AutoGPT again. And you will now see that the email plugin and the Wikipedia plugins will not show up in this list and they will automatically be pulled into our project. Of course, if you do not want to use any of these plugins, you can copy their names and then add them to the deny list, separated by a comma. So I'll just copy and paste a few of these, separated by commas, just to show the difference. So I'll save these changes and let's re-execute AutoGPT. And this time we were not asked to approve these plugins and they were automatically skipped. There are plenty of other plugins that we could cover and this list is growing all the time. And if we scroll down, we can see a list of third-party plugins as well. And it is possible for you to develop your very own plugins for AutoGPT as well. And if we go back to the documentation on the plugins page, there is another page dedicated to show you how to create your very own plugins. But that is technical and it's not something that we'll cover in this video. So please let me know in the comments if you want me to cover any of these plugins in a future video. Before we move on to the final part of this video, I first want to take a second to congratulate you for making it to this point. We definitely covered a lot of topics and you should now be comfortable with using AutoGPT by yourself. Up until now, we had a look at how we could run AutoGPT on our local machine, but it is worth looking into online alternatives. And in this final part of our course, we will have a look at two major players in the AutoGPT field. The first one of these online alternatives to AutoGPT, so to say, is called God Mode. And God Mode basically uses an AutoGPT instance behind the scenes. You can access God Mode by going to godmode.space. This interface should look familiar to you. As with running AutoGPT locally, we need to provide God Mode with a prompt. For instance, create a meal plan for losing weight. As an example, we can then press enter. And what God Mode will do is it will automatically try to generate the individual goals that need to be executed. And on this step, we can see some suggested goals. And we can add these goals by clicking on the add buttons. And then we can click on launch. And as with running AutoGPT locally, God Mode will also give us feedback on each of these steps. And we can see the individual tasks for the step on the left side of the screen. What is very nice about using God Mode is that it provides a very clean and visual representation of what is happening. And we can see in the processing that an agent was started, we are getting the thoughts as well as the reasoning, and we can also see the command that will be executed along with the arguments. And as with running AutoGPT locally, we are able to give it additional feedback. And this can be used to adjust the prompt and the direction that the AI is going in. We can also go ahead and approve this plan. What is also worth mentioning is that at this stage, there is no cost associated with running this service. And God Mode does give us a couple of free prompts without us having to pay for it. But you might see that during processing, God Mode will tell you that it's reached its free limit and it will ask us to provide it with an OpenAI API key. You can also set that up in advance by clicking on Settings And then in settings, you can go ahead and paste in your OpenAI API key. Also, you can change the model that should be used. And because we are still running on the free instance of God mode, it defaults to GPT 3.5, which is cheaper than GPT 4. But when you supply your OpenAI API key, you can change this to GPT 4 for better results. It is also worth noting that God mode is able to create files. And although these files are not written to your file system directly, they will show up on the left-hand side over here. And on the step, we can see that God mode is planning to write a file. So let's see if we can see the file being generated in this area over here, which it does. We can see the contents of any of these files by clicking on the file name, and that will bring up a pop-up with the contents. We can also download this file by clicking on the little download icon over here. God mode is very easy to use, and because it's running in the cloud, it's always accessible wherever you are. Another online alternative is called Agent GPT, which you can access on agentgpt.reworked.ai. And with Agent AI, we can provide a name for our AI, like Fitness GPT, and for the goal, I'll ask it to a workout plan for losing weight. And we can click on Deploy Agent. In order to run Agent GPT, we have to be signed in. And after signing in, the agent will start running. And also note, I enabled the web search option, which seems to produce better results. We can now see that Agent GPT has created the individual goals that need to be executed. And we are getting feedback for each and every goal as it's running. And Agent GPT will continue to create tasks and execute on these tasks until its objective is completed. Now you know how to run AutoGPT locally, and you also have access to online alternatives like God Mode and Agent GPT. If you made it this far, I want to thank you for going on this journey with me. And if you want to support my work, I would appreciate if you could like this video and perhaps subscribe to my channel as well. I highly recommend having a look at the rest of the videos on my channel, where I cover all sorts of topics like AutoGPT and many other topics on AI. I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.